Let's give a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, Leila Allen.
Hi, I'm Dr. Leila Allen, and I'm a neuroscientist studying molecular and behavioral changes related to dementia. I fell in love with the study of the brain when I was in college and became especially interested in identifying memory disturbances related to drugs and neurodegenerative diseases, especially Alzheimer's, which is the most common form of dementia. A little over 2 years ago, my dad died, just 6 months after being diagnosed with probable frontotemporal dementia. But he was exhibiting symptoms for at least 5 years that I should have picked up on as dementia, especially given my research background. How could I miss my dad's symptoms? His own doctors dismissed the unusual yelling, angry outbursts, and combative behavior as potential drug or alcohol abuse. Our family tried to get past these incidents and move on. But when my dad violently shoved my husband to the ground, unprovoked, I knew there was something very serious going on in his brain. After several months of neuropsychiatric evaluations and imaging studies, we got our probable diagnosis, the behavioral variant of frontotemporal dementia. So why probable? Because to this day, clinicians can only give a probable diagnosis for most dementias. The only way to diagnose with certainty is to analyze the brain after death. And after my dad died, because of his religious preferences and cultural customs, he was buried within days, and we were never able to obtain the postmortem brain analysis that would have been able to confirm his diagnosis. This plagues me. You see, in Alzheimer's, on top, different areas of the brain are affected than frontotemporal dementia, or FTD, and that accounts for the differences that emerge between the two. So in Alzheimer's, the primary concern is memory loss, while in frontotemporal dementia, memory can be spared, while the patient instead presents with extreme changes in personality, executive functioning, and sometimes language abilities. Frontotemporal dementia was first characterized 130 years ago. Alzheimer's, 118 years ago. Yet to this day, we still have no viable treatments or straightforward methods to detect these diseases before it's too late. And scientists are increasingly aware that changes in the brain related to these diseases can begin 10 to 20 years before symptoms are even noticeable. In fact, it takes on average 3.6 years to clinically diagnose someone with frontotemporal dementia, which is a very rare form, but is actually the most common form of dementia for people under the age of 60. Some things are changing. Awareness of FTD is growing with some high-profile celebrities going public with their diagnoses. And of course, many of us personally know someone affected by Alzheimer's or another type of dementia. The National Institutes of Health dedicates about $3.7 billion annually towards research for Alzheimer's and other dementias. But the cost to society in the U.S. alone is nearly 100 times that, at approximately $360 billion. We need to understand these devastating diseases much better. So how do we do that? Well, one of the most useful ways that we have for identifying and understanding how diseases work is to develop animal models. The most commonly used models for dementia are rodents, and especially mice, because their genome was the first to be mapped out. And that allows us to use previously established methods to genetically express the pathology. So, for example, their brains produce proteins that clump together to mimic specific protein aggregates found in specific dementias. However, mice do not naturally develop many diseases that humans do, especially dementia. And drugs that work well in rodents don't always translate well to humans because their metabolism and overall physiology is just so different from ours. And that's why at FIU, in collaboration with the National Swine Resource and Research Center at the University of Missouri, we've developed the nation's first pig model of Alzheimer's disease. Pigs have been used in biomedical research for decades because of their numerous similarities to humans. Their food they eat, their social nature, as well as their metabolic, renal, cardiovascular, lungs, skin, and many other organ systems. Yet, very few neuroscience labs use pigs. And though rodents have been incredibly useful for helping us understand many aspects of brain function, they simply do not have the similarities to humans that other animals, such as pigs, do. So, in the lab, we're using pigs to bridge the translational gap between rodents and humans. Pigs are very cute, as you can see. And they're also very smart, which we've demonstrated by running them through both rodent and human behavioral tasks. Sometimes they outperform the humans. And actually, when we compare performance in this classic maze paradigm, so this is a pig in our giant tea maze, we find that pigs can remember at least 10 times longer than mice in the same task. This is not only impressive, but it also allows us better sensitivity to subtle behavioral changes that emerge early in the disease progression. We also take videos of the pigs in the maze, and we put them into AI tracking software. So these are images of our pigs in the maze overlaid with AI software tracking that allows us to detect movement trajectories and predict behavioral patterns that humans might miss. And we hope that this will help us develop methods for detecting behavioral changes earlier in the disease progression. Because we know the earlier a person is clinically diagnosed, the better the quality of life for them and their families. Just think of what early, regular, and insurance-covered colonoscopies have done for the prevention of colon cancer, or mammograms for the early detection of breast cancer. We hope that someday we'll be able to find or administer a non-invasive and inexpensive test to detect changes in the brain before it's too late. And scientists have come up with some incredible potential methods, like retinal scans to spot Alzheimer plaques in the eyes that emerge early, blood-based biomarkers, and also tests that detect changes in sensory perception, like hearing loss or problems with a sense of smell, that can make a person more predictive of developing future neurodegeneration. Just imagine having a test like that incorporated into your annual physical. It'd be simple. We also know that people who see their doctors as soon as they begin noticing symptoms benefit greatly with better access to support services that can help them take control of their condition, live independently for longer, and also plan ahead for themselves and their families. Lifestyle changes can also slow or prevent future disease, such as reducing alcohol consumption, taking up exercise, establishing good sleep hygiene, eating a diet rich in anti-inflammatories and antioxidants, and especially addressing issues like type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular problems like hypertension and high cholesterol that can make a person much more likely to develop dementia. And the next best thing that you can do is be an honest and detailed historian of yourself to your doctors so they can truly piece together what's going on. I wish I had been more realistic when it came to my dad, but I've come to realize that sometimes we can explain away the behaviors of those closest to us. It's easy to dismiss symptoms or pretend it's not happening, but denial does not help. That's why I am on a mission to educate people about how science is addressing dementia. and where the problems lie in our diagnostic and translational pipelines. I see so much hope in our future, especially in my remarkable students, some of whom are here today, who will become the future brain scientists and physicians who will hopefully help you and your loved ones as you age before they get to the point that my dad did. If we all join this mission, either through education, activism, calling your congressperson to improve funding, or simply paying more attention to your aging loved ones, I see real hope in our future, fighting against these diseases that defy human resilience. Thank you.